In the 80s and 90s, Mel Gibson established himself among the Hollywood greats. One of the movies he especially became known for was the Lethal Weapon movies. Here in these action-packed movie series, he plays the cop Martin Riggs, creates a delightful contrast to his screen partner Danny Glover. This pair actually played together in 4 movies, and it was seen as a large success. It is one of those action comedies people remember, and these movies still surface on television today, which just confirms their large success. The action sequences in the movies is what really makes them exciting, and there are also funny scenes at the same time. It has grown to become one of the most appreciated action comedies of the 20th century. This is my favorite movies with Mel Gibson, which shows the appeal of many different generations, even years after they came out. There is also talks of making a 5th, but still, they have just been empty talks. Furthermore, in movies like Braveheart and The Patriot, Mel Gibson consolidated his role as a huge international movie star. In these war movies, Mel Gibson really shows his abilities as an actor, and they are known to be some of his best roles. He really fits the bill as both the soldier in Braveheart and his farmer role in The Patriot. In these movies, you really see why Mel Gibson reached the heights as one of the greatest actors in Hollywood. Maybe many people didn't hold him in such high regard as the likes of DiCaprio, Robert De Niro, and Al Pacino, but at least one time during his career, he could easily fit into almost everyone's top 10 list. Probably the problem with Mel is that he mostly takes on the same role as this tough sort of like badass good guy who you are not sure you can rely on. However, you see the diversity when comparing The Patriot to Deadly Weapon. Here you see a completely different Mel Gibson, but it's a crazier, badass style one you are used to see the most that you also mostly have seen on set. Mel's movie career is not only limited to just being the actor, he has also directed numerous movies. The Passion of the Christ is a lightning example of a movie that really has become an immortal movie in our times. Mel Gibson did not only direct this movie, he also did a screenplay. Although the movie never won the biggest award in the Oscars, it received numerous other awards, and its standing today is only cemented as a movie that people remember years after its release. Although Mel Gibson didn't play in the movie, he did a nice piece of work in making the tale of Jesus Christ's crucifixion feel and look more real and brutal. The story is so accurate that it feels like you actually are there and relives the moment in real time. Though, of course, we are not sure what really happened. What is also striking with this movie is that really only 2 of the actors in the movie, Jim Caviezel and Monica Bellucci, made their career take off because of this movie. When you think about how good it actually became, this is a very surprising piece of fact. Around 2014, Mel Gibson's career had a serious downfall. 3 years after his messy divorce with Robin Moore, he found himself nominated for these worst acting rewards, such as the reward for worst supporting actor. The movie he received that for was in The Expendables 3, where he showed that he had declined as an actor. Also, the movie was not seen as the best movie in the series, further perhaps making it natural to nominate him for such a reward. He is not really central in the movie, and that can be said for most of his later work. Already in Machete Kills, he casted his intro into bad movies. Here he plays alongside a crazy Mexican trijo, and it's really a forgettable entry. I mean, this movie is a hopeless waste of time, and I'm not sure as to why Mel wanted to make a role in this. Maybe it was because his time of getting the big roles in movies like The Patriot and Braveheart was long gone beyond him. Anyway, it's at least easy to fall down on that conclusion. I mean, an arms dealer who wants to launch a weapon into space, you don't get a more hopeless plot than that. But Mel Gibson, yes, maybe he needed the money. In Dead Is Home 2, he also played this badass tough love father type, which creates a contrast to Will Ferrell and Mark Wahlberg. But it's not a memorable performance, and in my opinion, this movie is highly forgettable. The first Dead Is Home was much more entertaining, in my opinion, and that just points to the fact that Mel's introduction into the movie didn't really help it. Again, it's just a minor role, and they could basically put just about anyone in that role. Maybe there are not too many tough love father types around, but I bet if they had looked on a bit harder, they would have another option. To cast someone for a minor role, I bet also is not a top priority for anyone. So I bet also that they didn't care too much as to have Mel Gibson there. I mean, what could go wrong? It's about Mark and Will, and they are the ones who should carry this movie. And it showed very much how hard Mel had fallen. Furthermore, movies like Boss Level and Fat Man never did anything to improve his fallen status as a movie star. Although the first movie here wasn't too bad, and although Mel's role is a return to form, it's nothing memorable, because it is Frank Grillo playing Maine who steals the spotlight here. There is also a minor role as a bad guy, who holds an interesting evil bad guy, who actually is not a too bad role. But like I said, it's not really one of those that stays in your memory. One interesting fact from this is that Mel is talking about the movie, as he likes to have these more laid-back roles, as he now lets the younger Frank instead do all the stunts he used to do in his earlier career, particularly from the Deadly Weapon movies. Still, I do feel that the roles like this don't exactly consolidate him as a good actor. He can still act, but I also just feel he did it better before. Later efforts like Dangerous and Panama contributed to the decline even more, and compared to the rest of the movies listed in this production, these movies are an outright bad piece. Dangerous gave him, like Bruce Willis, these Razzie Awards, where one of them was given to him for this particular movie, which is a forgettable action movie. Here he is only filmed on the phone, where he takes the incoming call of a psychiatric patient who is allowed to visit his family, and tries to avoid going back to his former ways of being a ruthless killer. In this role, he is very limited in the way he can act, but I will agree that he sounds a bit tired. He does a job, but not an exciting one. But it's quite easy to label known actors who get minor roles as acting bad. In the Panama movie, which hasn't been out too long, he has a little more central role as both a storyteller and a sort of like CIA boss. But this production is extremely bad, and probably the worst movie he has ever played in. I mean, even the credits in the beginning bore you, and they last 10 minutes. Although there are some action scenes in the movie, this movie really holds its place as maybe a new nominee for Razzie Awards. You have heard about the Panama invasion before, but even a documentary about that would have been more exciting. The storytelling for Mel is okay, but it's done a bit too much, and the characters like Enrique Rodriguez as this playboy drug lord is highly forgettable. As much can be said about the other people in the movie who just wasted their precious time in making it. Although it only has 610 votes, the 3.2 on IMDb tells the whole story of a movie who should have been thrown straight into the trash can. Yeah, that was my review. Thank you for watching.